बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। आई एम रियाज हुसैन जुनेजू एंड आई एम डिलीवरिंग द वीडियो लेक्चर्स फॉर द कोर्स ऑफ अप्लाइड इलेक्ट्रिसिटी एंड इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स। द कोर्स कोड इज CEE103 एंड दिस कोर्स इज बीइंग ऑफर्ड फॉर द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ दिस कोर्स इज बीइंग ऑफर्ड बाय द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इलेक्ट्रिकल एंड कंप्यूटर इंजीनियरिंग कॉमसेट यूनिवर्सिटी इस्लामाबाद वा कैंपस फॉर द सेमेस्टर ऑफ फॉल 2020। दिस इज सीरीज ऑफ लेक्चर्स एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस लेक्चर नंबर 10 एंड टॉपिक इज रेजिस्टेंसेस इन सीरीज एंड इन पैरेलल। दिस कोर्स इज बीइंग ऑफर्ड फॉर द प्रोग्राम ऑफ BA सिविल इंजीनियरिंग। दिस इज बेसिक इलेक्ट्रिसिटी एंड इलेक्ट्रॉनिक कोर्स। प्रीवियसली वी हैव डिस्कस्ड किरचॉफ करंट लॉ एंड किरचॉफ वोल्टेज लॉ एंड वी हैव आल्सो सीन दैट जनरली कंपोनेंट्स कुड बी इन सीरीज, कंपोनेंट्स कुड बी इन पैरेलल एंड कंपोनेंट्स कुड बी नाइदर इन सीरीज नॉर इन पैरेलल। सो इन दिस टॉपिक especially we are going to discuss what happens to resistances when they are in series or in parallel, how we can simplify or find the equivalent of the resistances when they are in either in series or in parallel, what is theory behind the series and parallel circuits, and we will be discussing the extreme cases of the series short circuit and open circuit as well. Again, for the students' information, these video lectures and slides are being prepared from the textbook of Fundamentals of Electric Circuits. The author is Alexander Sadiko. So let's start. We are actually discussing chapter number 2, and today we are going to discuss section number 2.5, series resistors and voltage division. Just like we have mentioned that there are three possibilities that any component could be in series with another, or it could be in parallel with another component, or it could be neither in series nor in parallel. So consider the single loop circuit shown. The two resistances R1 and R2 are obviously in series. So let's suppose we have a very simple circuit. We have connected two resistances R1 and R2 in series, that is they are connected in cascade such that at the joining point of R1 and R2 there is no third component connected. So obviously in this case R1 and R2, that is resistance 1 and resistance 2, are in series. So next we have also connected a voltage supply, that is battery of volts V. It is also in series with R1 and R2. So all these three components are in series. You can see that in this single loop circuit there are three components, that is one is voltage source and other is V1 and V2. So these two resistances R1 and R2 are connected across terminal A and B, that is starting point of resistance 1 is A and ending point of resistance B, resistance 2 is B, and they are connected here, that is they are connected in cascade. And similarly voltage source V is connected across points or nodes A and B. So this obviously a series circuit. So in this case we can see that only one current will be flowing, that is the current provided by the battery. So let's suppose that current is I, and since these three components are in series, so obviously there will be different voltages, voltage or potential across each component. So voltage across battery is V. So let's suppose voltage across resistance 1 is V1, and let's suppose that resistance voltage developed or dropped across resistance 2 is V2. So again you can see the polarity of V1 and V2, because I is going in this direction, so this will be positive potential point and this will be negative potential point. Again remember that current always from flows from positive potential to negative potential. So this is positive potential point, this is negative. Similarly, if we trace the direction of this current here in the resistance, this will be positive potential point and this will be negative potential point, and already we are given the polarities of the applied voltage, that is, this is positive polarity and this is negative. Again, remember that conventionally a current from the battery starts from the positive terminal and ends at negative terminal. So in this case, we want to find that what will be the equivalent or total resistance of these two resistance if we want to combine them, and what will be the value of V1 and V2. So this is a very simple problem. So we can apply Ohm's law. We can say that according to Ohm's law, V is equal to IR, since for V1 current is I, resistance is R1, so V1 will be equal to I multiplied by R1. Similarly, V2 will be equal to current in R2 is equal to I, resistance is R2, so V2 will be equal to IR2. So if we apply KVL to the loop in clockwise direction, again we have seen that how you can apply Kirchhoff voltage law. We generally prefer to apply KVL in the clockwise direction, so we can start from any point and continue touching each element. You can see that there are three elements, so there will be three different potential points according to KVL, so algebraic sum of all these voltages should be equal to zero. So if we start from this point, we are encountering a battery whose voltage is V, first polarity is minus, so minus V. Next we have encountered resistance R1, its voltage is V1, first polarity that we have encountered in going in clockwise direction is plus, so plus V1. Then we can go in this direction, again you can see clockwise direction, so this is positive polarity we have encountered, voltage across R2 is V2, so plus V2. So again we can come back to the same point, so there is no component here, so this algebraic sum of the voltage should be equal to zero. So we can solve for V, so V will be equal to V1 plus V2. Again, this is very easy, that since total applied voltage is V, so this applied voltage should be equal to the sum of the dropped voltages. So since there are two dropped voltages, V1 and V2, so their sum should be equal to equal to total applied voltage, that is V. So in this case V will be equal to V1 plus V2. So now we can substitute the values of V1 and V2 from these equations. So V1 will be equal to IR1 and V2 will be equal to IR2. So we can take common I, so this V will be equal to I multiplied by R1 plus R2. So we can solve for I, so I will be equal to V divided by R1 plus R2. So this is the total current that is supplied by the battery, and this same current is flowing through R1 and R2. Remember, current will be same in this whole loop because there is no division of the current. So this current will be provided by the battery and this current will be flowing through R1 and through R2. So now we have value of I, so we can easily find value of V1 and V2. So now we can use the value of I from equation 2. So in this case you can see that we actually can write that I is equal to V divided by R. If we can rearrange this equation, we can say that V is equal to I multiplied by R equivalent, where R equivalent is the sum of these two resistances, just like this, in this circuit. And now we can combine these two resistances and we can make one resistance that whose let's suppose name can be used as R equivalent or R total, and its value can be equal to actually R1 plus R2, that is sum of these two resistances. So this implies that the two resistances can be replaced by an equivalent or single resistor R equivalent whose value is R equivalent is R1 plus R2. So let's call this equation number 3. So in general, if let's suppose there are more than two resistances in series, so we can replace them by a single resistance whose value will be equal to R equivalent will be equal to R1 plus R2 plus R3 up to Rn, whatever number of resistances are connected in series. So we can combine them to form a single resistance whose value will be sum of the resistances. Or in general, we can write in mathematical form that R equivalent will be equal to sum from n is equal to 1 to n Rn, that is sum of all the resistances that are in series. So now we can determine the voltage across each resistor in the circuit shown. So let's this is the circuit. We want to find V1 and V2. Clearly, we can use Ohm's law, and we know now current and resistance value. So since V1 will be equal to obviously I multiplied by R1 according to Ohm's law. So in that case, V1 will be equal to, because I is equal to, from this equation, I is equal to V divided by R1 plus R2. So V1 will be equal to V divided by R1 plus R2 multiplied by R1. If we rearrange this, this will be R1 divided by R1 plus R2 multiplied by V. Similarly, V2 will be equal to R2 divided by R1 plus R2 multiplied by V. So these two equations are known as voltage divider rule or VDR, because remember that in series voltage is divided, current remains same. So we remember that voltage across R1 will be called resistance divided by sum of the resistance, that is a resistance where the voltage, total voltage is divided. In this case, total voltage is divided between R1 and R2. So sum of the resistance is R1 and R2 multiplied by total voltage that is being divided in between the resistance. Similarly, V2 will be equal to resistance R2 divided by sum of the voltage, sum of the resistances where voltage is divided, multiplied by total voltage that is being divided in between the resistances. So this is known as VDR or voltage divider rule, and this is very important and easy shortcut to determine the voltage in series resistances when we know total voltage across them. So in general, if a voltage divider has n resistances, that is R1, R2 up to Rn in series with source voltage V, then nth resistance Rn will have a voltage drop of Vn will be equal to Rn divided by R1 plus R2 up to Rn multiplied by V. So imagine that there are n resistance in series and still we have applied voltage V. So what will be the voltage across resistance R1? This will be V1 will be equal to R1 divided by sum of the resistances multiplied by applied voltage. Similarly, voltage across R2 will be equal to let's say V2, and this will be R2 divided by R1 plus R2, that is sum multiplied by total voltage. Similarly, if there is a third element in series, so the voltage across third element will be V3 is equal to R3 divided by sum multiplied by V. So in this case, we can easily find the voltage across each resistance when they are in series. Some important observations in these series resistances. From equivalent formula, we can see that current remains same, but voltage is different, and it is actually generally different. Voltage is equal on the resistances only when the resistance value is same. Just like, let's suppose this, if this is R1 is 10k and this is also 10k, then this value voltage will be divided 50-50. That is, if this is 10 volts, so 5 volt will be here and 5 volt will be here. This is the only condition that voltage will be equal. Otherwise, if resistances are different, then different voltage will be dropped. So this is basic property of the series resistance, that current always remains same, but voltage is generally different. Voltage will be same if resistances are same in value. Already we have mentioned that point. If the resistances are of same value, then they will be dropping the same amount of voltage across them. If there is an open circuit in series with some resistances, the current wouldn't flow and total resistance of the interconnection would be infinity. Again, this is very obvious that if there is open, that is, imagine that R2 is open. Open in that case means there is actually infinite resistance. So in this case, current cannot flow. So total resistance between terminals A and B will be equal in this case infinite. Again, remember R equivalent is actually resistance in across terminals A and B. Are actually, we say that resistance RAB as well. So if any of the resistance is open, then overall resistance will be infinite and current cannot flow. Equivalent resistance is larger larger than the largest resistance. This is again very important point that equivalent or total resistance of the series network will be larger than the largest resistance that is present in the network. Imagine that one resistance is 1 kilo and other is 2 kilo. So obviously it means that total resistance of these two, you know, if they are in series, it will be larger than 2 kilo ohm resistance. So larger the resistance is, higher the voltage drop across it. Again, this is again a very important point that if the resistance value of the resistance is larger, then it will be dropping more voltage as compared to smaller resistance. It means that actually to let the current flow, if the resistance value is larger, the more potential or actually some kind of push is required to allow that current to flow from the resistances. So next we'll see parallel resistances and current division. In this section we'll see that how we can combine or simplify resistances when they are in parallel, and how we can drive the current divider rule, and how we can apply the current division rule. So consider the circle. This is a circuit. This is a very simple circuit. There are two resistances R1 and R2, and it is these two resistances are connected in parallel with voltage V. So voltage V, so V, R1 and R2, R3 resistances are in parallel. So it means that voltage will be same, that is voltage across battery, let's suppose V. So same voltage will be across R1, that is resistance, voltage across R1 is V, and similarly voltage across R2 is V, but current will be different. That is, assume that total current provided by the battery is I. So in that case, this current will, I will be divided here. Some amount of this current will be flowing through R1, and remaining amount of the current will be flowing through R2. So let's suppose that current through R1 is I1, and current through R2 is I2. So you can see that this is node A. This is single node, because starting from this point to this point, there is no component interconnected. So this is single node. Similarly, this is single node. So in this case, we can easily apply Kirchhoff current law here to find the value of I. So since resistances are in parallel, so voltage across them is same. Again, you can see that while resistances are in parallel, because their starting point is node A and their ending point is node B. So starting point and ending point of resistance is common, so they are in parallel. So obviously we can say that voltage across resistance R1, already we have mentioned that it is V, so V will be equal to I1 multiplied by R1, and obviously voltage across resistance R2 is same as V, so this will be obviously I2 multiplied by R2. So in this case we can say that I1, that is value of our current through R1, will be equal to V divided by R1, and I2 will be equal to V divided by R2. So now we have the value of I1 and I2, so we can apply KCL here. That is, applying Kirchhoff current law at node A gives the total current as, obviously I is the incoming current at this node A, I1 and I2 are outgoing currents. So we can say that sum of the incoming currents is equal to the sum of the outgoing currents. So I will be equal to I1 plus I2, incoming current is I and these two currents are outgoing. And now we have the value of I1 and I2, so I will be equal to V divided by R1, and I2 will be equal to V divided by R2. So now we can simplify this equation as I is equal to V multiplied by 1 upon R1 plus 1 upon R2. So we can write down that I is equal to V divided by R equivalent, where R equivalent is the equivalent resistance of the resistors in parallel. That is, in this case, R equivalent, R 1 upon R equivalent is 1 upon R1 plus 1 upon R2. We have constructed or converted this equation into somehow Ohm's law. We know that I is equal to V divided by R, so we can convert this equation like that. So 1 upon R equivalent will be equal to R1 plus, in fact, 1 upon R1 plus 1 upon R2, or we can simplify that R equivalent will be equal to R1 R2 divided by R1 plus R2. This is the actually total resistance or equivalent resistance of two resistance when they are in parallel. So in, we actually memorize this like that. If two resistances are in parallel, total resistance across the terminals A and B will be equal to product of the resistance divided by sum of the resistance, that is R1 R2 divided by R1 plus R2. So equation number one is applicable only for the case of two resistances, especially this equation. Otherwise, we can generalize the equation. If in general, if there are n resistances in parallel, then obviously 1 upon R equivalent will be equal to 1 upon R1 plus 1 upon R2 plus 1 upon R3 up to 1 upon Rn. So this is the general equation of the resistances when the resistances are in parallel. So they are in a reciprocal of the equivalent is actually equal to the sum of the reciprocal of the resistances. Note that if all the resistances are same, then R equivalent will be equal to R divided by N. That is, if all resistances are of same value, then total resistance will be R divided by N. R is the resistance of single resistance. Also, R equivalent is always smaller than the smallest resistance. This is a fundamental property of the resistances in parallel, that total resistance will be smaller than the smallest resistance present in the network. We can also write this equation as G equivalent, that is equivalent conductance of the network will be equal to conductance of the first resistance plus conductance of the second resistance up to conductance of nth resistance. So you can see that in parallel conductance increases, but in series actually conductance decreases. We can also find the current in each resistance in the previous circuit as, just like we have mentioned that I1, equation for I1 was V divided by R1. In that case, we can say that I1 will be equal to V is equal to actually I multiplied by R equivalent divided by R1. This is total voltage, and obviously total voltage will be total current multiplied by total resistance. So total current is I and total resistance is R equivalent or RAB divided by resistance R1. So we can substitute the value of R equivalent. So I divided by R1 and R equivalent for the case of two resistance was product of the resistances divided by sum, that is R1 R2 divided by R1 plus R2. So we can actually cancel R1 here, so I1 will be equal to R2 divided by R1 plus R2 multiplied by I. So you can see that now current is actually divided, and it depends on the opposite resistance. If we want to find the current through I R1, actually in numerator we have to use R2 divided by sum multiplied by total current that is being divided. Similarly, we can say that I2 will be equal to now R1 divided by R1 plus R2 multiplied by I. You can see again that if we want to find the current through resistance number 2, so in that case we have to use a value of R1 in the numerator divided by sum of the resistances multiplied by current. So these two equations are known as the current divider rule. These are again very important equations. These equations are used to find the current when a given current is divided in between two parallel resistances. Smaller the resistance, the larger the current through. And this is again obvious that if the value of the resistance is smaller, it will actually allow more current through it. If the value of the resistance is larger, in that case obviously small amount of current will be flowing through that resistance. Some important observations in parallel resistances: voltage remains same, but current is generally different. Current is same if the resistance value is same. So current will be same if the resistors are of same value. If there is an open circuit in parallel with some resistances, the current would still flow and the total resistance of the interconnection would not be infinity. Again, remember that current will not flow only where the circuit is broken or open. In remaining elements of the circuit, there will be current. So total equivalent resistance would not be infinity. It will be actually non-zero. If there is a short circuit in parallel with some resistances, current would only flow through the short circuit branch and the total resistance of the interconnection would not would be zero. Actually, the total resistance of the interconnection would be zero. Again, if there is a short circuit present in the parallel circuits, the current will be flowing only in the short circuit. There will be no current in remaining elements, and actually total resistance of the circuit will be zero. Equivalent resistance is smaller than the smallest resistance. This is this point we have already mentioned. Larger the resistance, lower the current flows through it. Again, we have already mentioned this point that if the value of the resistance is larger, it will draw a small amount of the current as compared to small resistance. So extreme cases, short circuit in parallel. What happens when there is a short circuit in parallel? So let's suppose I current is incoming and there is a short circuit in parallel with R1. So it means that R2 is zero. In this case, obviously what will happen that this whole amount of current will be flowing in this path because there is almost zero resistance. So we know that current prefers the path with minimum resistance. So here there is virtually no resistance. So all of the current will be flowing through this path. So current through R1 will be zero. So open circuit in parallel. So if R2 is open, in that case, this let's suppose I is the total current incoming. So this total current will be flowing through resistance R1, and there will be no current, or I2 will be equal to zero. This can also be verified theoretically using current divider rule. But from this diagram, we can see that because there is open, the current will not be divided here. All of the current will be flowing through R1. Whatever the resistance value is here, there will be no current here. Thank you so much. Next, we'll be seeing the examples related to series and parallel resistances. Thank you so much again.